Starting in 3ds Max 2018.2 update, the Path Deform modifier has seen some extensive and long overdue improvements. If you have used this modifier before, then you know that there were in fact two versions of it, a world space modifier and an object space modifier. The world space modifier is still there in its older form, but only for compatibility purposes. The object space modifier is where all the improvements have gone, and this is what you are encouraged to use now. Let's experiment a bit, but to make things a little bit more interesting, we'll also use the freehand tool with constraints. You will use the tool to simulate a gopher making its way underground. Open the file named gopher.max. It shows a flat plane that has been edited to show some bumps. This was done by using freeform tools such as push and pull and relax and soften. When you have an object such as this one selected, and then go to the Shapes panel to add a freehand object, then you have the option to use constraints to add the selected surface as a drawing board. This means that you can now draw a freehand object that follows the topology of the terrain. And so, you now have a path to deform an object along. Next, you'll create such an object and use a simple box. Create a box that's 4 by 2 by 10 in length, width, and height. Apply an object space path deform modifier. It's really the only one you want to use from now on. If you have used it in the past, you'll notice that it offers many more options than before. Start by placing the box on the path using the button currently labeled None. Click the path in the viewport. Like the old modifier, you can adjust the position of the box on the path using the percent value or the deformation amount using stretch. Also, as before, in order for any object to deform properly, it needs to have the appropriate level of detail. Go back to the box level in the modifier stack and set the height segments to the maximum value of 200. Go back to the path deform level and experiment with percent and stretch. Make sure you set them back to 0 and 1 respectively when you're done. As you can imagine, these values can be animated, and we'll get to that in a moment, but first, note the auto option. You can use this option if you intend for the path to cover the whole path length. This is the same as typing the auto value displayed in the stretch value box. In this case, we don't need this option as the goal is to animate the stretch effect. Make sure auto is disabled and that the stretch value is set to 1. Enable auto key and go to frame 80. Change the stretch value to be slightly less than the maximum value displayed in the auto label. Scrub the animation to see the results. Disable auto key when done. Mind you, you'll only use this object to select vertices on the ground. You won't need to render it. With the box still selected, go to its properties and make it non-renderable. Next, select the terrain and enable Edge Faces mode using F4. Add a volume select modifier and set it to vertex mode. In the Select By rollout, use the Mesh object option and select the box as the object that controls vertex selection. You probably won't see much happening just yet, so use Soft Selection to spread the selection further. You may need to adjust the falloff somewhat. Finally, add an X-Form modifier and move its gizmo up to lift the section where the gopher passes through. Scrub or playback the animation to see the results. Path Deform can also be very useful in a motion graphics context. Open the file named f1logo.max. It shows two simple splines that, when put together, can make out the logo for a Formula 1 ad. create a box in the top view, make it about 10 by 10 by 30 in size. It needs to be a bit more detailed, so turn it into an editable poly object. And in poly mode, delete the top and bottom caps. Switch to edge mode and chamfer the vertical edges a little. With the vertical edges still selected, connect them using about 25 to 30 segments. Exit sub-object mode when done. Add a turbo smooth modifier on top for good measure. This will add detail and round off the edges a little. Add a path deform modifier to the box and set it on the first spline. Set the stretch value to 0 and then enable auto key. Go to frame 80 and animate the stretch value so that the deformation reaches the end of the path or slightly before it. Scrub the animation to see the effect. Next, clone the box using Ctrl V. Make sure you use the copy option as you're about to change paths. Change the path from line 1 to line 2. Delay the starting deformation of the second box by moving frame 0 to frame 25. This way, the deformation of box 2 only starts when that of box 1 reaches it. You can fiddle with the position of the keyframe if you need to. You may also need to adjust the value of the last keyframe, as the length of the two paths are not necessarily equal. Exit auto key mode. An important aspect of Path Deform is how it treats materials. You can certainly assign specific materials to each deformed object, but interestingly, you can inherit material IDs from the underlying paths. Go back to frame 0 and select the second path. Go into segment sub-object mode. Select all segments and note that by default, they are all on material ID number 1. This is the case for any new line you create. You can change this status and create some interesting results. For example, you can readjust the spline by creating an extra vertex using Refine, and then set segments to a different material ID such as number 2. The idea is to make the 1 in Formula 1 more prominent. Exit sub-object mode when done. Scrub the animation again to see the deformed boxes and select the second one. Note the option to adopt the shape material ID. Enable this option. Actually, enable also the same option on the first box. You might as well, since you will be using the same material for both. Go to the Slate Material Editor and create a multi-sub-object material based on two sub-materials. Add two sub-materials. Keep it simple and use physical materials based on a template such as glossy paint or polished aluminum. Just change the colors to something you like. Apply the multi-sub object material to both boxes . Scrub the animation. You may not necessarily see the correct effect in the viewport, but try a few test renders at different stages of the animation. You'll notice that the color changes as soon as the deformed object reaches those segments with a different ID. A test render is far more accurate at discerning the material cutoff point. Finally, you can add more inventive effects by animating rotations and twists.